Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Secretary Biegun. Since 2015, I've had the privilege of serving as the chairman of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee Subcommittee on East Asia, the Pacific, and International Cybersecurity Policy, where Senator Markey and I have led efforts to shape a new policy toward the Indo-Pacific region, including through the passage of the landmark Asia Reassurance Initiative Act in December of 2018. As part of our work in the 115th Congress, the East Asia-Pacific Subcommittee also held a three-part series of hearings titled The China Challenge, which examined in a comprehensive manner how the United States should respond to a rising China that seeks to upend and, no doubt, supplant the U.S.-led liberal world order in their minds. Our first two hearings focused on security and economic aspects of China's authoritarian rise, including China's debt trap diplomacy and military modernization programs. Our third hearing focused on democracy, human rights, and rule of law, values that have been fundamental to the conduct of U.S. foreign policy for generations. Our witnesses testified that we are in the midst of the so-called authoritarian closing that under President Xi Jinping has resulted in an unprecedented and intensifying crackdown on civil society, ethnic minorities, and religious freedom in China. We found that the mass concentration camps for Uyghur Muslims in the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region shocks the conscience and necessitates a serious response from the United States and the international community, including sanctions against top officials. We found that the crackdowns in the Tibet Autonomous Region are intensifying, while Beijing continues to refuse negotiations with the Central Tibetan Administration. We found that human rights defenders in China are routinely jailed, tortured, and otherwise deprived of liberty. We found that genuine freedom of speech and assembly are non-existent, that corruption and abuse of power are rampant. Just look at Hong Kong and the violations of international agreements registered with the United Nations, and the lengths that the Communist Party in China will go to deprive its people of what China itself not too long ago had agreed to. And now in the midst of the unprecedented outbreak of COVID-19, coronavirus, the Communist Party of China continues to hide and obscure critical information that has imperiled a truly global response to the crisis. This is the China that we must deal with, not just now, but for the long run as well. I look forward to hearing from Deputy Secretary Biegun today and how we can best address the China challenge together. In a series of questions, I want to talk about the Asia Reassurance Initiative Act and what it means to the framework, as you identify in your opening statement. But just a few quick questions. Is China torturing Uyghur Muslim population in China?
I'm sorry, Senator, could you repeat the question?
Is China torturing Uyghur Muslims in China?
We certainly believe that there is a severe mistreatment. In fact, we and many other countries are demanding access to Xinjiang and to the
You're not willing to say whether or not they're torturing?
I don't have, torture is a legal definition, and I don't simply have the evidence available to me to,
but you would agree
to make that statement
been...
as a legal matter. I do believe they are severely mistreating those people, and it possibly
And you would
could.
Agree there have been public reports that Uyghur populations have been tortured?
I certainly find it believable, sir.
Is China disappearing scientists and dissidents? Scientists dealing with the coronavirus, dissidents speaking out against Chinese repression?
China has been arresting dissenting voices for my entire career, but in recent months, we have seen, in particular, this focus has turned against those who spoke up, particularly early on, regarding the COVID virus in Wuhan. Absolutely.
Is China stealing U.S. coronavirus research?
As the Department of Justice unveiled in two of its indictments yesterday, we have firm evidence to suggest that Chinese hackers working in close association with Chinese national security institutions have, in fact, been trying to steal information related to the development of technologies to treat the coronavirus.
Is China breaking the Rose Garden promise of no militarization of the South China Seas?
As I mentioned in my earlier comments, one only need to type into your search engine on your computer, South China Sea military bases, and you will see how substantial China has broken the pledge that President Xi Jinping made to President Obama.
Is China persecuting other religious minorities like Christians?
Absolutely.
Is China breaking international agreements in Hong Kong?
They have broken their international agreement in Hong Kong.
This obviously is something that must be dealt with swiftly, strongly, and not just by the United States, but the global condemnation and action subsequent to that condemnation that will show China and the Communist Party of China that their actions are unacceptable of a responsible if they wish to be deemed or seen as a responsible nation. The Asia Reassurance Initiative Act, which passed in 2018, sets a framework. In your testimony, you state that The Asia Reassurance Initiative Act is a framework for U.S. leadership in the Indo-Pacific. It's based on the National Defense Strategy, National Security Strategy. Just out of curiosity, how can we use ARIA, that framework, to address the challenges and the consequences of the actions China's taken as it relates to the questions you just answered?
Yeah, similar to what we welcome in Chairman Risch's legislation, laying out a strategic framework and knowing that it is creating a space for us to make proposals here to Capitol Hill on budgets and priorities is very helpful. The authorizing committees do play an important role in telegraphing to the entire department set of professionals the space that we can move into as we go annually through our budgets and staffing issues. Your legislation, which has already been in place for several years, was very useful in that regard. We've seen a complete reorientation of U.S. foreign policy towards Asia-Pacific, consistent and even in some ways through the openings that were suggested in the ARIA legislation. The more focused efforts on China are going to likewise need close congressional and executive cooperation, Senator. And I want to thank you and members of the committee for a number of pieces of legislation that I highlight in my written testimony that have come out in recent years.